I'm with Hilary Garivaltis, who is Executive Director of National Ayurvedic Medical Association. Welcome to this, and thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me.
And also, you were the former head of and the founder of the Ayurvedic Institute in Kripalu.
That's correct.
When was that?
I started the Kripalu School of Ayurveda at Kripalu back in 2005.
Kripalu Center is one of the major centers in the United States, probably the largest, originally founded by a Hindu guru, named after Kripalu, and started by Yogi Amrit Desai a long time ago. That is where they did the original transfer to the United States of Yoga Nidra, a lot of great things, and also teacher training of Hatha Yoga teachers a long time. And it's expanded now. And you have an Ayurvedic Institute there.
Yes.
Giving treatment.
Yes.
And educating people.
Yes.
But your main affiliation now is with NAMA, the National Ayurvedic Medical Association.
That's correct.
So we are going to talk about Ayurveda in the United States, because you are the face and the spokesperson representing Ayurveda in the United States. How big is NAMA, this association? Is it growing? How many people are into this, as practitioners of Ayurveda? How do you certify them? And what is its situation regarding getting health insurance coverage? Because one of the problems is that conventional medicine doesn't recognize it enough to get health insurance coverage. We'll talk about all that. What's the politics? What's the science? Why people here in the United States are liking it? And adopting Ayurveda, and yet at the same time, it's not getting equal treatment for medical insurance and so on. So we'll talk about all these things.
Okay.
And I also want people to know that her teacher, Dr. Satyanarayan Das, is also someone very close to me. We're very good friends for a long time. And we've just finished recording 50-some episodes of Sanskrit Non-Translatables. And we're going to edit and launch that series. So just to get that out. So tell us about NAMA, the National Ayurvedic Medical Association.
Very good. Well, NAMA was conceived back in 1998 by a small group of concerned Ayurvedic schools, actually, and professionals. And they batted around the idea of pulling the community together and into an association. For a few years, it was very disparate at that time. You know, few schools around the country, only maybe two or three, and teachers that would come from India, do a little teaching, and then leave. So there wasn't a real formal set of schools and programs other than maybe Dr. Vasant Lad's Institute, the Ayurvedic Institute. In New Mexico, there was the California College of Ayurveda out in California, and then there was the New England Institute of Ayurvedic Medicine, which was my alma mater.
When did you go there?
I went there in 1997.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So you've been in this 22 years.
Yeah, I have. That was my first foray into sort of a more formal introduction to Ayurveda, other than reading Deepak Chopra's book.
So how many places of training Ayurvedic doctors are there now in the U.S.?
So there are three tiers of professionalism in Ayurveda. We have the Ayurvedic health counselor, which is a diet and lifestyle, almost like a health coach.
Okay.
So there are probably about 30 of those programs out there.
30 programs?
30 programs offering a certificate of completion for an Ayurvedic health counselor.
So that's the lowest level?
That's the lowest level, minimum 600 hours. The next level is what we refer to as the Ayurvedic practitioner, which is probably around 1,500 hours. And there probably are about 15 of those programs out there. And they're often the same schools offering each of those programs, and they're kind of tiered. And then we have the top of the line is our Ayurvedic doctor, which we would consider equal to the BAMS of India, the Bachelor of Ayurvedic Medicine and Surgery. That is the degree given in India. It would be that level of training and curriculum. Currently, there's only one school in the country that is offering a 4-year program.
Where is that?
That is actually in Boulder, Colorado. It's called Alandi Ashram. It's a very small school, and the principal teacher has a Western medical degree and background, and then trained in Ayurvedic medicine.
So when you go for a 4-year, what's the prerequisite? Do you go after high school, or you have to have a bachelor's degree?
Well, here in the United States, usually it's at least high school, obviously. There isn't a prerequisite other than getting a little biomedical training, like anatomy and physiology, to enter in. And then the rest of the curriculum is embedded into the program.
So we have three levels, the coach, the practitioner, and the doctor.
Yes.
So how many coaches are there in the U.S., roughly?
So we have somewhere around, the ones that we track, I mean, we're one association in the United States and probably the biggest Ayurvedic association. And not all of the professionals out there are members of our association yet. We have about 1,500 members, and of those, about 1,000 are professional members. And we have somewhere around 300 health counselors and probably closer to 600 Ayurvedic practitioners, because we did a grandfathering.
Right.
And we have somewhere around 100, now it's growing, of Ayurvedic doctors. And a good deal of those are doctors that got their degrees in India that now live in the United States and practice here. So we have a good deal of BAMS doctors.
So the coaches, which is the lowest level, is it their full-time job, or is it somebody who is actually doing something else but became a coach also?
There's a mix, and we haven't really pulled a survey and a data recently on that. There are a few that do it full-time, and then there are many that it's a part-time job. And then there are many that have folded it into their already licensed profession, because Ayurveda...
What could be that main profession?
It could be doctor.
Okay.
It could be a nurse or nurse practitioner. It could be, a psychologist.
So there are mainstream Western MD doctors and psychologists who are also becoming coaches in Ayurveda.
Yes.
As a supplement.
Yes. And during my tenure at Kripalu as the dean... I would get at least a quarter of my students from the allied health professional field. And they were fascinated with the approaches that Ayurveda takes to help understand individuals. Ayurveda is really shines in the viewpoint of looking at someone uniquely, and then applying the proper principles for balance and health to that individual, which is very different than the Western medical model or other models of medicine out there.
And personalized, individualized is the thing.
Yes.
So I want to come back to that when we talk about DNA, because now the DNA guys are wanting to do that also.
Uh-huh.
So,
uh-huh.
But first, this just to understand the landscape more completely, the education at different levels, to what extent are people in med schools, like somebody in Harvard Medical School right here, or people who are going to become doctors, to what extent are they interested, and to what extent is Ayurveda medicine available to them? Or is it part of complementary medicine or something else?
Well, every medical school is unique with their curriculum these days, and there are a few, and I haven't actually investigated fully the different schools, but there definitely are a few that are at least exposing their students to a little bit of Ayurveda. Every year I do a webinar with students in medical school. They have their own association, and now I can't remember the acronym for it, but they themselves have taken on the charge to learn a little bit more about complementary medicine, and they always invite me every year to talk to them about Ayurveda.
So give me an example of a school which is good host for Ayurveda, open-minded, a medical school. Which would be like your favorite and say, okay, that's a good one?
I don't have a personal relationship with any of them other than my connections here through the Benson Institute and the group here. I know that Duke University does a lot more with alternative medicine, and they have an opening. I know that Arizona does through, you know, Dr. Weil. You know, and they include little pieces of
Andrew Weil.
Yeah. They include little pieces of Ayurveda, but I don't know a medical school that really embraces it yet and that would offer a full class, you know, on Ayurveda. Bastyr University, which is an alternative, you know, medical school of Chinese medicine and naturopathy and all, had a full master's program in Ayurvedic medicine. So there are some openings in some of the accredited universities for including Ayurveda in their curriculum, but there's still a little reservation around jumping into it because it is a foreign medicine with lots of funny words and names, and it has a really different philosophy.
I think that's the key, because the concept of who are we treating, who is the person, is a very different physiology, different anatomy, different concept of being.
It is, and the energetic being, the idea that everything is energy, and we translate everything through a language of energy in Ayurvedic medicine. And that's maybe Western medicine is beginning to catch up with that, but it's a concept that is embedded in what we are. And so it takes a little bit of a mindset twist for a Western medical professional to be able to understand and see that. With the popularity of yoga having really grounded itself, I think, now in the United States, and that took, you know, 30, 50 years to happen, there's much more openness to Ayurveda as its sister science. At least people are willing to listen to it, and there's so much overlap in the philosophies between the, it's rooted in the Vedas.
The 600 members you have, plus many that are not members, as practitioners, do you think they're doing this full time? Can it sustain a full time living, or is it a supplement to something else?
It usually is a supplement at this point. And the full time living is something that will happen as we become a little more established and well known, and we can practice out there more freely and in collaboration, you know, with other, you know, medical institutes, so people can build more confidence around it. One of the issues, I don't know if you're ready to jump into this yet, is that we are an unlicensed profession.
Yes. So tell me about that. Okay. How do you feel that this is not sort of legit and the legally?
Right.
And so the Ayurvedic practitioner has to make you sign all kind of things like, I'm not claiming to be a medical person and all that.
Right.
And I'm basically educating you and you can treat yourself.
Right.
That's sort of the posture.
Yes, exactly. Well, you know, back in the 30s when the first Medical Practice Act was put in place, it was such a broad definition. It took in everything. You know, even recommending an herb to a friend or, you know, having a casual conversation around your health, it became the domain of the Western medical doctor. And anyone who stepped over that line could be prosecuted for practicing medicine without a license. So that took away naturopathy, it took away homeopathy, it took away
even
Western...
Even Chinese medicine,
Western
acupuncture
herbal...
Acupuncture people want to be... clear that they are not claiming to be doctors.
Right, yeah, when they should, you know, when their full scope of practice, traditional Chinese medicine, is as vast and complete as Western medicine. So we have to work toward educating and potentially even changing that practice act, but that will take more effort. So what is happening across the country is something called health freedom legislation or safe harbor legislation.
Yes.
You'll hear both those terms used. And it's to protect, there's two aspects of it. One is to create more health choices to the consumer to the individual and allow them to become aware and understand the vast breadth of professionals out there, from people practicing Reiki to people practicing Ayurvedic medicine, you know. So that's one aspect of health freedom legislation. It's to provide access to a wide variety of health choices. The other part of it is to protect the unlicensed professional so that they won't be constantly under the threat of being prosecuted for practicing medicine without a license. So about 10 states of our 50 states have passed legislation.
Oh, really?
And some of the first out of the gate were Minnesota and California. Hmm. And California probably now, it's at least 15 years, could be 20 years, that they've had the health freedom legislation
out there.
Anything
on the East Coast?
Rhode Island is the only state in this area. And their law is a slightly different, but it's basically a health freedom law. And I think Alabama down south, but on the East Coast, even the Midwest is not
quite surprising.
Much.
Yeah. The so-called liberal East Coast. Is not liberal in terms of this. Chinese medicine has the advantage that the Chinese government has really backed it.
Yes.
I mean, they've really gone and lobbied for it, and the certification, the education. And so as a result, the export of Chinese medicine is many, many fold more than the export of Ayurveda.
Right. And
the practice of Chinese medicine is in a different league altogether.
Yep.
When we're counting Ayurvedic practitioners in the hundreds, they're counting Chinese doctors in the thousands.
Yes.
In the US.
That's true.
So their country has backed their traditional system a lot better.
Yes.
That's an India problem.
Yes, and I think that's true. You know, traditional Chinese medicine and acupuncture is about, 20 to 30 years on us as to being established here. And they started off very much like we did, with very small programs, maybe a year's training and all of that until they could transition. And then they moved into licensure fairly quickly along the way. But you're right, the Chinese government really supported and backed them, which gave them a stamp of approval that the United States couldn't ignore.
See, and they don't have this colonial complex like India does.
Right.
And they don't have this complex that we got to prove that we are like the West.
Right.
And we are secular, we are like them. And in order to get admission and in order to be treated, get a seat at the table, we have to become like you to be okay.
Yeah.
They don't have that inferiority complex. So the Chinese have asserted their own distinctiveness in every field, including medicine, and done well as a result.
Yeah.
Whereas in India, it's always, are you some problem? What's going on? There's some kind of suspicion towards somebody who says, okay, this is an old civilization, has its own strengths, and has so many things to offer, Ayurveda, yoga, meditation among them. And let's be very clear about it.
Right.
So India is way behind China in that regard. It's a psychological quality that the Chinese have over the Indians in terms of confidence in themselves.
Oh, that's interesting. Interesting viewpoint. And I can understand that from my experience with it. And so the National Ayurvedic Medical Association is really poised to, place Ayurveda squarely in the middle of the, healthcare in the United States, and to stand up very tall around it and to say, this is who we are, this is what our practice is, this is what we can offer.
So how do you do this lobbying? Are you in Washington?
Well, right now I'm actually here in Boston at the State House. We're trying to put forward a health freedom bill here in Massachusetts. I was just here 2 days ago. We finally got two sponsors. We're ready to get the... We've tried before and it didn't make it. And I'm with a whole group of other unlicensed professionals. I'm representing Ayurveda, but there's hundreds of other alternative health professions out there that are at risk at the moment. So we are working here in Massachusetts to get, and I'm encouraging other Ayurvedic professionals in other states to, if they don't already have legislation going forward, to do this. This is one step for us. It at least secures us as professionals. And for the health counselor and even the Ayurvedic practitioner, health freedom legislation may be just enough for them to practice carefully, openly, and not be concerned. For our Ayurvedic doctors, we do believe that we do want to move toward licensure of our profession in the United States. And that's a state-by-state effort. Colorado is has currently put forward an application to their Department of Licensure for Ayurveda.
So is there somebody in India helping you in North America, or are you on your own?
Well, we're trying to make some good connections with the Ayush ministry.
Okay.
They've come and supported our conference before, part of our conference. We know that there are avenues to the government and to, in certain ways there, and Ayush is sort of the group that we should be working with. The Boston Center of Excellence is you know, partners in
and
with
by the
them.
Way, my Infinity Foundation is also a partner, a member of the Boston BCE.
Wonderful. So we're all in good company. And
yes.
I think what's going to happen with these sort of collaborations is we will get more of a seat an ability to speak to, you know, the people in India that can help us. And I think what we're trying to do at NAMA right now is develop a very strong certification exam. We've created a certification board and an accrediting body. Those are two very important things. Three important things that you need to have before you really move into legislation on licensing as a profession. You need to have a very strong membership community. And show that you've got, you know, professionals out there and that they're unified. You have to have defensible certification exams properly designed and implemented, which NAMA invested in these last 4 years. We've created two of those exams. We're creating the doctor exam right now. And we have a certification board to review it. That's number two. And number three is to have an accreditation council that actually overviews the education and the programs. And we are just launching that now. And NAMA's actually in the middle of a fundraiser to raise money to really ground and establish our accreditation board. Once all those things are in place, we are in really good shape to then move into discussion with legislative, you know, agendas around potential licensing.
I want to move to provocative topic.
Okay.
So the provocative topic is that I'm studying a phenomenon where the Western mainstream, when it encounters something non-Western which is good, keeps it outside the legitimacy boundaries, doesn't destroy it, reject it because it's something is good too, mm-hmm. about it.
Yeah.
Doesn't want to bring it in because there's a threat perception. Doesn't want to get rid of it because it's something useful. So it has to be kept at arm's length so one can mine it as needed, selectively pick this, bring it in, change it, include it as our own, pick that, try it,
right.
but not
right.
bring the whole system in because it may threaten. So I call this process digestion. So it's like, you know, a predator digests a prey. Of course, that's a mean analogy, but that's what it amounts
okay.
to.
Yeah.
And when a predator is done digesting the prey, there's no more prey left. I mean, he's finished. What you don't need is claws and his feathers or whatever is thrown out, you know, or excreted. So the useful thing becomes part of the predator's DNA, part of the predator's cells, becomes part of that, you know.
Right.
And what wouldn't fit the genetic makeup of the predator is rejected. So this is I call the digestion of a non-Western civilization or a system. And I'm studying this in many areas.
Yeah.
There are individuals involved who go study, they come back and then they rewrite it, everything as something that came from Plato or somewhere like that, whatever, or Western science or whatever. Mm-hmm. So we've seen a lot of these things happen at the individuals who do this. I call them U-turn, that they kind of go and U-turn back. But then there are organizations and institutions collectively doing this, and I call them stomachs. So the mouth is one individual here, one individual there. They bite a little bit, chew it, you know. But then all these many, many mouths feed a stomach, and then the stomach kind of digests it. So is there a risk And I want to understand this from you as a spokesperson on the Ayurveda side. Mm-hmm. Is there a risk that Ayurveda is being kept outside the boundary of legitimacy and at the same time being mined for all the goodies it has to offer? Because Western medicine at the research level is furiously studying all these things. I mean, they're studying ashwagandha, they're studying, you know, turmeric, right. There's turmeric latte now. They're studying not only individual concoctions, but also the methodology. The methodology of personalized medicine. Mm-hmm. So there's people studying from the DNA genetics level that all these claims about, you know, personalizing the medicine, what's good for you is not good for the next person, even though they have similar symptoms. That kind of an Ayurvedic thing is working its way into personalized medicine.
Right.
So do you feel that there is this digestion going on?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Because in the long run, they're putting you out of business. They're using you in a sense saying, go and bring all this to us. We're not going to legitimize you, but whatever you're offering, we'll keep picking here and there, and we'll give you some few carrots, you know, as incentives to keep you going.
Right.
And then in the end, we're going to digest all this and we'll say, thank you, and you're out.
Right.
So what do you think of all this?
Well, it's very interesting, the time that we're in, when it's happening in the age of the internet and everybody can sell something and buy something and read about something and sample something that, you know, is so widely available. So much of Ayurveda can be really watered down and used inappropriately in all these ways by taking one herb like ashwagandha and capitalizing on it.
And taking one molecule out of it.
Taking one molecule out of it.
And patenting it and saying, here's a pill.
And then here's a pill, and it's an Ayurvedic medicine,
which
you know, isn't.
Right.
That's not Ayurvedic medicine.
Good. I'm happy to hear that.
And so we have to really... That's why I feel Nama is so important as the voice of Ayurveda in the United States, and why we have to have very strong educational institutions and certification so that the public knows that this is a person that's truly trained in Ayurveda. They did a 4-year program in it, as opposed to someone that may be a Western medical doctor, and this happens a lot, that will go and get a minimal amount of training and then use Ayurveda and use it well, actually. I'm not saying this is a bad thing necessarily, because they're using components of Ayurveda that are helping their patients. And in the end, that's all any of us want to do. But as long as they're representing themselves appropriately by saying, you know, I'm not an Ayurvedic doctor, I didn't get that training, you have to go and get this kind of training. So we're hoping at some point that we'll help to educate the public and, you know, the professionals.
About what's distinct.
About what's distinct and why you have to understand the full system of the medicine in order to apply it appropriately.
Yes, and you know, not being legit means that the Ayurvedic practitioner is at a handicap in defending.
Yes.
Because if you were to go to a court, or if you were to go and make an ethical issue, they'll say, but who are you? Nobody even knows of you. You're not even legit. So as a non-legit, so this is another thing that is used a lot. People are delegitimized so that they cannot defend their intellectual position and the system that they come from.
Right.
Because they don't have all the rights. You know, people who are not legit, supposedly, in the eyes of the public opinion, don't have rights.
Right.
So this is a very serious matter.
It is.
All these are related issues. Not allowing Ayurveda practitioner to be considered legit means you not only don't get the insurance coverage, the financial benefit, which medical doctors do.
Right.
It also means you cannot defend the practice, the medicines, the techniques, the know-how, the intellectual property. You cannot defend that because you're not legitimate people.
Right.
Meanwhile, the very same thing, which is so-called not legitimate, is there is a frenzy of digesting it.
Yeah.
So to me, the issue of digestion should be put on the table. And I would love to come and talk at one of your conferences on this issue.
Yeah.
Because I think if we have more Ayurvedic practitioners talking about, hey, listen, guys, you're digesting ashwagandha. But when I prescribe it, you don't want me to do that.
Right.
When you prescribe it, just because you've characterized it as, you know, yours now.
Right.
So recharacterizing the property as sort of Western science certified means that now it's legit.
Right.
And so the people who really brought it for thousands of years are out.
Right.
This is unfair.
Right. And, you know, I like to look at the pros and cons on both sides all the time. And we have such a mix of members in our community. And Ayurveda wouldn't be here in the United States if some of this didn't happen.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So there are some people that promoted it and promoted it on a surface level, but they promoted it, you know, and the word Ayurveda suddenly became known.
So who are some of the pioneers?
Well, the Maharishi Mahesh Yogis Institution.
But they were not, they didn't compromise. They're still into the Ayurveda.
No, they did. And Deepak Chopra was the spokesperson for them. And Deepak had a masterful talent in translating things into English. He started that conversation. And, you know, I honestly wouldn't have known about Ayurveda if it hadn't been for his book, Perfect Health. Which, you know, looking back on now, I read it and, well, you know, it was so basic.
But it
opened a door for me.
Yeah.
And it opened a door for many, many people.
Sure. I've known Deepak for a long time. In fact, we went to the same school in Delhi.
Oh.
And that's how I, you know, when I went to his clinic way back into his clinic to get treatment.
Yeah.
His childhood photograph was there and it had the same tie and I said, oh my God, this guy must be from the same school. So we kind of rediscovered that.
Yep.
I respect his pioneering spirit, and he did a lot of fighting, got a lot of flack for it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you think his Ayurveda clinic and his treatment is still authentic Ayurveda, or do you think that the trade-off is that for popularity's sake he's diluted?
I think that he wisely adjusted aspects of Ayurvedic treatment for America. And he and John Duyard were really responsible for helping to start up many of the clinics, and Jay Glazer here in the United States for the Maharishi. And you couldn't take the traditional methods of doing, say, an Abhyanga on a wooden table with hardly any clothes on and slapping people around with lots of oil. You couldn't translate that treatment, as it's traditionally practiced in India, to the United States without having a lot of problems. So they really skillfully adapted the treatments without really sacrificing a lot, but making it more friendly to, you know, our environment here. So there are things like that that they had to do. They had to shorten, you know, the treatment length because it would have been exponentially expensive for someone to do the longer Panchakarma treatments.
So one of the things that I look for is what I call Sanskrit non-translatables.
Mm-hmm.
So with Satyanarayan Das, your mentor, I've done a whole series on Sanskrit non-translatables.
Yeah.
And now we're looking for specialists in Ayurveda, in yoga, in various kinds of disciplines, in Jyotish, who will do Sanskrit non-translatables with us.
Yes.
For that domain.
Yes.
So now, do you feel that it is important as a prevention of this careless digestion, you know,
yep,
to preserve certain terms like dosha, like pitta, like prana, and not sort of replace them with English equivalents that are diluting?
I agree. And with that, I agree wholeheartedly, you know, but you still have to translate enough
to explain
and to get people, you know, interested enough. And I was put in a very interesting position as a Western woman who only came to Ayurveda in my early 40s. So I knew a little yoga, you know, I had meditated for years, you know, I was introduced actually to transcendental meditation in college in the 70s, like so many people in the 70s did.
I was a 1970s TM initiate.
Oh, yep, me too. 75 was my year, I think. And it wasn't like I jumped into it embracing the Vedic culture or anything like that. It was an incredible tool for me.
Yes.
And it opened a door.
Yes.
And so part of this digestion is taking things in bite-sized pieces so that there is an opening and an awareness that grows. And then I was fortunate enough to land at Kripalu. And the whole story there was sort of crazy. I didn't intend to start a school for them. I didn't have the capacity. I didn't know anything about any of that. But they urged me into it, and I had no idea what I was doing. And I was just sharing with students to begin with, you know, my experience of these steps that I took to embrace and begin to understand Ayurveda. I didn't understand dosha. I studied with teachers here and in India. I still didn't know what a dosha really was. You know, it's such a complex concept. And I shared that with my students. I said, this is a complex concept. We're going to start here with you, but I guarantee you it's going to get more deeper and deeper. And we may in 4 years not completely understand what a dosha is.
So complexity does get simplified when you do digestion, no doubt.
Yeah.
So, you know, a tree has roots from where the final product is fruits.
Yep.
If you harvest the fruits, it's very nice and tasty and it's quick, easy.
Yeah.
But if you destroy the roots, you won't get any more harvest.
That's right.
So the ethics is that if you harvest the fruits, you must nurture the roots.
Right.
So Ayurveda has roots, and these roots need to be nurtured.
Yes.
So if you just say, okay, they discovered ashwagandha, we'll just take it and clinically test it and make patents and we are done.
Right.
Then what you are doing is you're destroying the roots of a methodology,
right,
a discovery system,
right,
which has its own legitimacy.
Right.
So while there is Chinese science behind their medicine, and there is Western science, and there is also Ayurveda science, there are different sciences because people have discovered different ways of looking at the body.
That's right.
And like the men, blind men looking at different parts of an elephant, they all needed to complement each other.
Right.
So when we say complementary medicine, it should not just be, let's take the final products and include them and repatent them. It should also be, let's take the roots of the system and respect it.
Right.
So therefore it means that just like people spend many years understanding anatomy in the Western sense and physiology and so forth, there's nothing wrong if they have to spend many years to understand what dosha is.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah. So I think the protecting the integrity is a long-term benefit.
Yep.
A short-term would be, let's get rid of all the complexity, make it simple, and in one generation we'll market a lot of these products, we'll become famous and rich and done.
Right.
So I think the early pioneers may have a vested interest to compromise.
Yep.
Some of the early pioneers.
I think they did. Honestly, you know, they had to in order to interpret it for the masses that were sincerely interested in learning this. And there's something magical about yoga and Ayurveda. When someone steps through that doorway, it does something to our consciousness. And so there's now this hunger. You know, we introduced it back in the 80s here in the United States. There is now a really deep hunger for authentic education and for really understanding the roots of all of this.
So now let me take the provocation to another level.
Okay.
A good example of digestion is Aveda. Aveda stands for Ayurveda. That's where the word comes from. And the couple that invented this Aveda company, I got to know them. In fact, Bob Thurman introduced me to them at a restaurant in Manhattan way back, and I had this discussion about, you know, the whole history. And what I found out is that this couple used to go to India. They had a guru in Rishikesh. One visit they fell ill and some Ayurvedic guy came and treated them, and this was a chronic problem which got solved. So they started bringing back suitcases of they were like the 60s hippies, mm-hmm. and they brought back suitcases to sell and get their recover their plane tickets.
Yeah.
So this is how Aveda company started.
Okay.
And then they had some little newsletter of all the 5 or 10 or 20 different medicines they brought, sell it to their friends in a newsletter. Then it became a mail order business. Then they started bringing in bulk and repackaging it nicely for Western consumption. And then they finally got some farmers to come and bring back clippings and grow them in this country. Mm-hmm. So they brought the whole thing in stages gradually.
Mm-hmm.
And there is an occasional mention in their ad that this is some, you know, Eastern wisdom stuff. And once in a while they'll say Ayurveda also in their packages. But this is a very, very large cosmetics and, you know, skin products and all that, the largest in the world, owned by Estee Lauder, a multi-billion-dollar enterprise. There is nothing of that size anywhere else in the world in this space, including in India. None of the Indian companies are even comparable in size. So they've taken over a whole segment of the market using Ayurveda digested into their own patterns and so on.
Right.
Now there is a, you could say, yes, they've brought the benefit and they've made a lot of money on it. But they haven't done a whole lot to nurture the roots.
Right.
They're going to this country, that country, picking this, picking that, like scavengers, like, you know, people who go and plunder. It's like intellectual plunder.
Yeah.
In a sense.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd ask them, the gentleman is dead now, but when I asked him, why don't you take, they're not charging you royalty, because they're not smart enough to have lawyers after you. You should, of your own, as a dharmic thing, say, take a certain percentage and say, I'm going to go back and invest in an Ayurvedic school in India.
Right.
And I'm going to invest in farmers and teach them and let this continue. I'll nurture the soil from which came the harvest that I've made my billions on.
Right.
And they didn't do that.
Yeah.
So what do you think of that, the ethics of that? Don't you think that there is a human ethics that says whatever we get the benefit from, we ought to reinvest and encourage it more? And maybe suppose in their lifetime they had created, 5,000 Ayurvedic doctors by starting an institute. They certainly had the money to do that.
Right.
I mean, they could even put their name on it.
Yeah.
You know, and at least continue that science.
Yeah.
And let it blossom, let it produce more discoveries, more of this. What do you think of that issue?
I think it's profound. I believe that we all should be feeding back to the mother, to Ayurveda, all of us that have benefited from it in any way, because it needs our support and it needs protection, in order to grow. We really need to protect those roots, and we need to stand up strong for it as a profession, and as a science.
Yes. And
yes, I do believe that, and that's one of the things that I think I've learned from the Indian culture, and or at least remnants of the Indian culture, that in many families and traditions, it's embedded that you give back.
Yes, you give back.
That you go back and you help your village, or you obviously take care of your parents, and you all of these things that if you got benefit and were nurtured through life, you give it back.
One day, Western medicine and Western health sciences and wellness industry will realize the interconnectedness also. And right now, the high-tech machinery is going down to the DNA level and validating a lot of this. Yesterday, I had a discussion where right here in Harvard Medical School, they validated, with the help of somebody in Florida, ashwagandha as a treatment for cancer. And so it's one thing to say, okay, we're validating this, we're validating that. But the interconnectedness of humans, plants, animals, ecosystem, nature, the cycle, giving back, and why that is needed for our own health is something yet to be done, but I think an important milestone in the future.
It absolutely is. And I think that the Vedas speak of it so beautifully, and Ayurveda being, an Upaveda of the Vedas, it's embedded in our study and science that everything is interconnected.
Yes.
And that everything needs to be honored and respected in its own way, and that's the only way to really live.
Yes.
And that's what I love so much about Ayurveda.
Well, thank you so much. This has been a wonderful conversation. You're a great champion. We're very proud of you.
Thanks.
And let me know how we can work together and support this, because this is a great cause.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much.
Sharing.
Thank you so much. Thank you for watching. You can subscribe here and also hit the bell icon to make sure you get notified. To donate, please click this button.